Okay, I'll just go ahead and get started. Good morning, everyone. My name is Suzie Noh, and I'm in the accounting group. Thank you all for the opportunity to present my dissertation. I'm very excited to be here. So the question I ask in my dissertation is, does financial reporting facilitate the strategic role of investment? So specifically, when firms are required to increase their disclosure of investment, do they change investment to affect competitors in a way that is beneficial for their own future profits? So in the accounting literature, how financial reporting affects investment through changes in costs associated with moral hazard or adverse selection has been relatively well documented. And the novel feature of my study is examining the effect of reporting on firms' incentives to change investment to affect competitors' actions. And this is referred to as strategic investment in the related IO literature. And following that literature, I'll use this term throughout my presentation. So my study is mainly motivated by this idea that investments are more likely to affect competitors' behavior when they're more observable to them. And financial reporting increases this observability. So before I explain to you my setting and my specific hypothesis, I'd like to give you a quick preview of my main findings. So first, I find that after increased mandatory reporting of investment, firms change their investment in the directions that induce less aggressive behavior from their competitors. And this is consistent with how the theory would predict if firms were strategically changing investment to increase profit. Second, I show that this finding is concentrated among firms with large market share, which have the ability to affect competitors' actions. And last but not least, I show that these changes in investment by large firms impact future competition as these large firms achieve higher sales or higher profit margins. So together, I argue that I provide novel evidence that financial reporting can increase the extent to which large firms engage in strategic investment, and that this has real effects on firms' competitive dynamics. So now I'd like to introduce a regulatory setting that I use to test my research question. So I exploit a 2003 disclosure regulation implemented by the Securities and Exchange Commission, or the SEC, that required firms to increase their investment disclosure. So a key feature of this regulation is that it required firms to provide tabular information in a single location of their annual financial statements. And as you can see in this format that firms had to follow, firms are required to provide, and this disclosure was about their off-balance sheet contractual obligations, and firms are required to provide this disclosure by specified category, including long-term debt, capital leases, operating leases, and purchase obligations, and others, and by specified due dates, so total less than 1 year, 1 to 3 years, 2 to 5 years, and more than 5 years. And it's a well-known fact that before the regulations, firms were already required to aggregate and disclose their payment obligations for various contracts, including long-term debt, capital leases, and operating leases. So according to SEC, this 2003 regulation newly required disclosure of purchase obligations. And purchase obligations are defined to be executory contracts or executory portions of contracts to purchase goods or services that are legally binding on the firm. And they consist of a broad set of arrangements, including inventory purchases, CapEx, R&D, advertising, strategic alliances. All of which are very informative about firms' future strategies. And what I argue in my paper is that this setting, this 2003 regulation, is particularly suitable for testing the role of reporting on strategic investment. And this is because purchase obligations capture the key features of investment that are identified in related theory. First, purchase obligations are irreversible as they reflect legally binding amounts of purchase commitments. Second, they're time-bound or timely because they need to be signed in a timely manner before future production or sales. And third, they're observable, and this regulation made them more observable to competitors. And according to theory, the irreversible and time-bound nature of investment makes investment credible, and its observability helps investments serve a signal about their future strategy. So these three features of investment together make investments signal a commitment to future strategies that is credible enough to affect competitors' actions. And competitors' actions in turn affect firms' own future profits. So this effect of investment on profits that channels through the actions of competitors is called the strategic effect of investment. While the theory I rely on takes this observability of investment as given or fixed, I use this 2003 reporting regulation as a key source of variation in the observability of investment. And then I examine whether firms engage more in strategic investment after this regulation. And as I alluded to earlier, this is based on the idea that investments are more likely to affect competitors if competitors can see it better or can see it in a more timely manner. So here I have an example of the tabular disclosure provided by company Boeing in the year after the regulation. I want to emphasize that the magnitude of purchase obligations can be very large to some firms. So in this example, Boeing reported total purchase obligations of about $43 billion, which is about 80% of its total assets. And if you look at the columns on the right, that the amount of purchase obligation due in 1 year, which is about $19.4 billion, turned out to be about 40% of the investment that the company made in the following year. And this example is not an outlier. For my sample firms, I find that the average amount of purchase obligation over total asset is about 51% for firms reporting purchase obligations, and 25% even after including firms that do not report purchase obligations, which I record as zero. And additionally, I also find that the amount of purchase obligation due 1 year is on average about 30% of the investment that firms make in the subsequent year. So hopefully this statistic suggests that the disclosure required by the regulation likely provided some meaningful information about firms' investment and therefore their future strategies. So now that I introduced my setting, I'd like to discuss my hypothesis. My hypothesis rely on theory on strategic investment that is developed in early seminal papers in IO. In the appendix of my paper, I derive and discuss this theory in more detail. But today, for the sake of time, I will quickly go over some high-level ideas just to provide a framework for my hypothesis. So the theory classifies competition into two types: competition with strategic substitutes and competition with strategic complements. And it makes opposite predictions across the two types of competition for firms' optimal level of investment that are visible to competitors. And I base my predictions on this theory, and I also make opposite predictions for how firms would change their investment after the regulation. Because the notions of strategic substitutes and complements are fundamental to my predictions, I'll spend the next few minutes explaining what these are. The first thing I want to clarify is that this classification has nothing to do with whether firms' products are substitutes or complements. All products here are imperfect or perfect substitutes because I'm looking at direct competitors. This classification instead has to do with whether firms' strategic interactions are substitutes or complements. So in this first case, the term substitute is used because the actions chosen by competing firms have a negative relationship. In this case, a firm's more aggressive strategy reduces other firms' marginal profits and consequently makes it optimal for them to be less aggressive. Here I'm using the term dominant firms to refer to firms with, I think I dog check, but I'll just move on. So I'm using the term dominant firms to refer to firms with large market share, which have the ability to affect competitors' actions. So changes in the aggressiveness of dominant firms lead to changes in the aggressiveness of non-dominant firms. So far, I haven't specified a unit of aggressiveness, but this can be in quantity, quality, price, or any other factors that can affect how well firms' products can sell. So a classic example of this is Cornell quantity competition. So for example, Coca-Cola facing quantity competition with its non-dominant competitors like Shasta and RC Cola would be classified as having strategic substitutes. I want to emphasize that I am assuming that Coke competes in quantity for the sake of illustration, which I'll come back to later. So assuming Coke competes in quantity, if Coke increases its quantity, the best response by its competitors would be to reduce their quantity because if increasing coke quantity reduces the market prices of their products by the law of demand and reduces their marginal profits of producing more. In this other case, the term complements is used because the actions chosen by competing firms have a positive relationship. So in this case, a dominant firm's more aggressive strategy increases other firms' marginal profits and makes it optimal for them to be similarly also more aggressive. Alternatively, a dominant firm's less aggressive strategy reduces other firms' marginal profits and induces them to be similarly less aggressive. A classic example of this is for trend price or quality competition. So, for example, Boeing facing quality competition with its non-dominant competitors like General Dynamics would be classified as having strategic complements. Again, assuming Boeing competes in quality, if Boeing engages in less aggressive engine development, the best response by its competitors would be to also engage in less aggressive strategy because they can all benefit from having a less competitive environment. And another way to explain this is Boeing's less aggressive strategy reduces competitors' marginal profits of improving engine quality. I want to emphasize that I'm just using Coke and Boeing for illustrative purposes. Empirically, it's really hard to classify a firm as having quantity competition versus price or quality competition because in reality, they have discretion over all of these factors. So when I classify competition type, I follow prior literature and use an empirical measure that is specifically designed to estimate whether a firm's more aggressive strategy increases or decreases competitors' marginal profits. So my hypothesis. So one common theme across the two sets of competition is that dominant firms always want their non-dominant competitors to be less aggressive. And this is intuitive because firms can increase their profits if their competitors sell fewer products, which are considered substitutes by consumers. And to induce their non-dominant competitors to be less aggressive, dominant firms generally, with strategic substitutes, generally adopt more aggressive strategies, and dominant firms with strategic complements generally adopt less aggressive strategy. And as a reminder, investment credibly signal the aggressiveness of firms' future strategies because they're irreversible and observable and time-bound. And the regulation I study makes investment more observable to competitors, and therefore further increases these dominant firms' ability to use investment as a signal. So my prediction is that after the regulation, dominant firms with strategic substitutes will increase investment to signal a commitment to increase aggressiveness, and those with strategic complements will reduce investment to signal a commitment to reduce aggressiveness. And this is my main set of hypotheses. To test my hypothesis, I run a diff regression. The key independent variable, which...
I need to interrupt you, Suzie, because you're over time. So can you wrap up, please?
Okay, please. Sure. So I find result consistent with my regression, prediction, showing that firms with strategic substitutes significantly increase their investment if they have substitutes and significantly reduce investment if they have complements. And I find that non-dominant firms in response engage in less aggressive behavior after the regulation. To summarize, the answer to the question of whether financial reporting facilitates the strategic role of investment is yes. And I provide novel evidence that financial reporting can allow firms, especially large firms, to engage in strategic investments. Thank you.